In 1889, Italy was struggling with its identity. It was a brand new country, and many of its people didn't yet feel united as Italians. This fact upset the first queen of Italy, so she decided to take a trip to the southern Italian city of Napoli in the most rebellious part of the country at the time. The queen, meanwhile, had grown tired of her royal diet of haute French cuisine, so she decided to try something different. She called upon a local Neapolitan restaurant owner, Rafaelle Esposito, to come and cook for her, as she wanted to taste the charm of the local food of Napoli. Esposito decided to cook three different types of pizza for the queen. The first pizza had tomato sauce, oregano, and olive oil. The second pizza had tomato sauce, cheese, and local anchovies. But it was the third pizza that would go on to make history. Esposito wanted to make a pizza that would honor the queen and the new Italian flag. He used tomatoes to represent the red, mozzarella cheese for the white, and basil leaves for the green. The queen loved this pizza so much that Esposito decided to name it after her. And this is how Pizza Margherita was first created. Some people believe that this pizza story was a royal psyops. The ingredients' colors matching Italy's flag, and the story of a queen who likes everyday people's food might seem a bit too perfect. Some people think that the royal family made up this story to help bring Italy together, and even to Italianize the country. What do we mean by Italianize? Aren't these people already Italian? Well, a northern Italian politician once quipped that, "We've made Italy. Now we have to make Italians." He was commenting about how hard it is to bring different groups of people together under one flag. Making a country into a united nation is about more than just politics. It's about culture. In 1861, Italy unified into one country. But some parts of it were not as happy about this new setup. For example, people in the area that used to be the Kingdom of the Two Sicilies began an insurgency called the Brigantaggio. This uprising lasted nearly 10 years and took over 100,000 northern Italian troops to crush. An Italian scholar said that the south of Italy was kept in the new state only by bayonets. The idea of nationalism is actually pretty new. People didn't really start thinking about countries this way until the mid-1800s. After all this unrest and rebellion, it would make sense that the government wanted to calm things down and find ways to make the whole country feel united and bridge the cultural divides. Pizza, at this point, was the food of the Neapolitan peasantry. It wasn't fancy, and it was seen as a commoner's food. The author who wrote Pinocchio, who was from northern Italy himself, had this to say about pizza. "Do you want to know what pizza is? It's a flattened piece of leavened bread, toasted in an oven, topped with a sauce made with a bit of everything. That black of the toasted bread, that whitish garlic and anchovies, that yellow-green of the oil and fried herbs, and those red pieces of tomato here and there give the pizza an air of complicated grime, which corresponds perfectly with that of its cellar." At the time, Napoli was known more for its disease outbreaks than as a place to visit, and the rest of Italy looked down on it because of that. So, what have we got? We've got a poor population of southern Italy who eat pizza. We have a wealthy northern aristocracy who do not eat pizza and even look down upon it. And these people are now united into one country. How do we fix this? The only evidence of the encounter between the queen and Esposito is a letter, supposedly sent by the queen's servant, thanking Esposito, currently on display in the Pizzeria Brandi of Napoli today. However, the authenticity of this letter has been called into question. Maybe this Pizza Margherita story wasn't so much the queen's idea, but more a plan from an advisor in the ruling family to improve their popularity with southerners and the working classes. Some people called this kind of thing inventing tradition. For instance, pizzas with tomato, cheese, and basil on them were seen as early as the 1840s. So maybe the marketing was invented in 1889, but the pizza definitely wasn't. But even if the history is not entirely accurate, maybe nobody cares. The vibe of the story is the most important part and reflects how Neapolitans and other Italians love margherita pizza, right? When you think of Italy, you think of tomatoes. Italy is one of the biggest tomato producers in the world. They've created famous types of tomato varieties like Pomodorino Vesuviano, Cuore di Bue, Pacino, and San Marzano. And they use tomatoes in so many famous dishes. But it's not only pizza that most Italians didn't eat before the 1800s. Most Italians didn't eat tomatoes at all. Tomatoes were seen as a strange and maybe even poisonous plant. The botanist Giovanni Domenico Sala of Padua said that only the unwise ate tomato, and he associated it with eating various kinds of insects. Actually, this fear wasn't entirely unwarranted. The acidic juice from the tomato would run all over the pewter dishes of the wealthy, thereby leaching the lead from the plates and killing people. Tomatoes were first grown by the Aztecs and then brought to Europe by Spanish colonists. At the time, southern Italy was ruled by a Spanish king. It was here in Naples that an Italian chef first cooked tomatoes in the, as they called it, Spanish style. He also wrote down the first recorded instance of tomato sauce in Italy. What might seem like timeless Italian food culture only caught on in Italy during this time. The first description of a zucchini occurs in a work published in Milan in 1901. So no fried zucchini flowers, no chilies or pepperoncini, and therefore no pepperoni in America, no potatoes for gnocchi, no maize for polenta, no basil for pesto, no tomatoes for any of these dishes. By 1800, tomatoes were common in southern Italy, mainly because they were cheap and easy to grow in that climate, but they were still not so common in many other parts of Italy. However, that all changed in the 1860s, when a new technology from France made its way into the country, enabling the tomato to reach more people. It was called heat-sealed glass bottling. This brought about the emergence of passata, basically bottles of boiled and sealed tomato sauce, and it also made it possible for those living far away from tomato farms to also enjoy tomato sauce. Around this time, people from Napoli and Campania started moving to places like America, and they brought their local pizza culture with them, spreading this new part of Italian culture. And in America, Italian Americans will say their food is food from the old country.
The mother country.
And yet at the time of the American Revolution, many Italians were eating essentially French and Spanish cooking.